This section we're going to talk about dividing numbers, dividing whole numbers specifically. So far we've talked about multiplication. We're going to talk about division and talk about how multiplication and division relate to one another. So let's first start by naming some of the components of a division. So let's say that I have 75 divided by 3, and that gives me 25. And before we go off into specifics mathematically, let's just keep something in mind. So we can relate this to an example in which you have $75 and you want to divide it amongst 3 people. So each person would get $25. So this is the idea behind division. We're trying to break up some amount into another set of amounts. So the number we're breaking up, the number we're dividing, in this case, the $75 we already have, that's going to be called our dividend. The number we're dividing it by, or the number of people we want to break it up into, this is called the divisor. And finally, the answer out of dividing those two is called the quotient. And quotient is always going to relate to division. So whenever you hear that keyword quotient, you should know to go ahead and divide. So I can write this same problem in a number of ways. I can write it as 75 divided by 3 gives me a quotient of 25. 75 over 3 gives me a quotient of 25. This bar right here is called a fraction bar. We'll talk more about that later. One more way I can write this is 75 divided by 3 equals 25. So in all of these cases, the 75 is the dividend, the 3 is the divisor, and the 25 is the quotient. Okay. Now, division and multiplication are related to one another. We know that 75 divided by 3 is 25. And the reason is, if you were to take your quotient times your divisor, you would get your dividend back. So we know that 25, that's my quotient, times my divisor, which is 3, would give me 75. So just like addition and subtraction were related to one another, multiplication and division are related as well. So we can do stuff like that. For example, 40 divided by 5, we all know that's 8, because this is the way we check our work. 8 times 5 would give me 40. So if I can take my quotient times my divisor, I should get my dividend back. Remember, this was my quotient, and then this is my divisor, and I got the dividend back. So that's how we check if we did something right. Okay, there are some properties we have to keep in mind about division, just like we had properties about addition and multiplication. So the first property we're going to learn about is about the division properties of 1. And there's 2 of them. And the first one says that any number divided by itself is going to give me 1. And that makes some sense. If I have, for example, $75 divided by 75 people, each person's going to get $1. The other property we're going to talk about is when you divide any number A by 1. The quotient is going to be A. And that, again, makes some sense. If you have $75 divided by 1 person, well, that 1 person is going to get $75. Talk a little bit about the division properties of 0. And these are worth knowing because people often get confused with these. So the division properties of 0. Again, there's more than 1. The first one is that 0 divided by any number will be 0. That makes some sense. If you have $0 divided by 5 people, each person is going to get $0 out of that. The other property is that any number divided by 0, that's going to be undefined. This one we're just going to learn for now. There's one more. 0 divided by 0 will be undetermined. And we can go into explanations about why this is the case, but for now, just go ahead and memorize that 0 divided by any number is 0, any number divided by 0 is undefined, and 0 divided by 0 is undetermined. So now that we know the basic rules behind division and their properties, let's talk about doing long division. So let's say, for example, that I wanted to divide 4,908 by 6. So 6 would be my divisor, 4,908 would be my dividend. My divisor is going to go into my dividend. So in long division, I write this as 4,908 divided by 6. The divisor always goes into the dividend. What I'm going to do is I'm going to go digit by digit in the dividend and see if the divisor 6 goes into the dividend, which is in this case 4. So 6 does not go into 4, so now I'm going to try 49. Does 6 go into 49? 6 does go into 49. It goes into 49 8 times. So I'm going to write that 8 in the rightmost digit. And then 6 times 8 is going to give me 48. So I'm going to multiply my quotient so far times 6 to get 48. And I'm going to subtract my answer. So 49 minus 48 is going to give me 1. I'm going to bring down the next digit, which is 10. Now I ask myself, does 6 go into 10? 6 does go into 10. It goes into 10 a total of 1 times. 1 times 6 is 6. I subtract my two numbers, and my difference is 4. Now I bring down the 8. Does 6 go into 48? It does. 6 goes into 48 8 times. My remainder is 0. If my remainder is 0, then that means that my quotient is 818. That means that 4,908 divided by 6 is 818. And I just put money there, because if you think of it as money, if you have $4,908 divided by 6 people, each person gets $818. So just thinking of it as money really helps some people easier to understand. Now, if it's been a while since you've done this, or if maybe you learned division in a different country, this might be a little bit different. But it's worth learning just so that you don't get confused and you can follow along in class. Let's try another one. Let's find the quotient of 2,212 and 4. And again, that keyword quotient, that should ring a bell. That means division. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to divide 2,212 by 4. Alright, now again, I'm going to start over here. Does 4 go into 2? And it does not, so I'm going to move one over. Does 4 go into 22? It does. It goes into 22 5 times. 5 times 4 is 20. My remainder is 2. Now I'm going to bring down a 1. Does 4 go into 21? It does. 5 times. When I subtract 21 and 20, I get 1. Bring down the 2. Does 4 go into 12? And it does 3 times. My remainder is 0. And again, my quotient is 553. We can check both of these answers because multiplication and division, remember, are related. So to check my first answer, I can check it by multiplying my quotient times my divisor. And if I did everything right, I'm going to get back to my dividends. I'm going to get back to 4,908. And this one, the other problem on the right, let me check that by taking my quotient, which is 553, times my divisor, which is 4. Now I'll let you go ahead and check those on your own. And what should turn out is that this answer should be the same as the dividend. You should get 4,908 for the first example and 2,212 for the second example. I will let you go ahead and do that on your own. Okay, so far we've had remainders of 0. If you look at all the remainders, we have a remainder of 0 there and there. You're not always going to have a remainder of 0. So let's talk about when you have remainders and what they mean. So one of the examples we can do is we can try, so let's do an example where we can divide 939 dollars by four people. We want to know how many dollars each person gets. Okay, so we're going to do long division. 939 divided by 4. I start to ask myself, does 4 go into 9? 4 does go into 9 a total of 2 times with a remainder of 1. Bring down the 3. Does 4 go into 13? It does. A total of 3 times. Difference is 1. Bring down the 9. Does 4 go into 9? It does. A total of 4 times. My remainder is 3. So here's what we have. We have that if I want to divide whole dollars, we're not talking about cents. Let's say we can't make any change for a dollar. All we have are whole dollars. If I want to divide $939 by 4 people, each person is going to get the quotient. So each person is going to get $234. And it just so happens that there's $3 left over that I can't divide amongst 4 people. If all I have are whole dollars and no cents, those $3 can't be divided against the 4 people. So we call that a remainder. So whenever you have that, we can just write our answer as $234 remainder 3. And later on, we're going to talk a little bit more about how we can make that. Maybe we can talk about cents, so we can talk about fractions, but we'll get into that later on. And to check these answers, well, we can start by checking doing what we already know. We know that if I take my quotient, which in this case was 234, times my divisor, that should give me my dividend, but in this case I have a remainder, so I need to go ahead and add that remainder, which in this case is 3. So let me go ahead and add this. 4 times 4 is 16, carry the 1. 4 times 3 is 12, and 1 is 13, carry the 1. 4 times 2 is 8, and 1 is 9. So again, 936 plus 3, which is actually 939. That was my dividend, so I know that I did everything correctly. Let's try one more just to make sure we drive this point home. So let's say that I wanted to divide 81,605, and I wanted to divide that by 9. Well, 9 doesn't go into 8, but it does go into 81, a total of 9 times, because 9 times 1 is 81. Sorry, 9 times 9 is 81, then I bring down the 6. Now, 9 does not go into 6, so what I need to do is I need to multiply by 0 so that this becomes 0, have a remainder of 6, and I can bring down the next 0. Okay, now does 9 go into 60? 9 does go into 60 a total of 6 times. 60 minus 54 is 6. I bring down the 5. Does 9 go into 65? And it does, a total of 7 times. And I get a remainder of 2. So my answer is 9,067 remainder, that's a 7, remainder 2. You can check again by taking my quotient, which is 9,067 times my divisor, and adding to that my remainder. I will leave that up to you, but your answer should be 81,605.